Hello everyone, I'm Glenda with SureFit Designs. And the purpose of this next short video series is to show you how to get from your drawn out body blueprint to this final testing stage where you put it on your body and you see if the blueprint fits for your unique body shape and size, or if you need to do any refinements or minor tune-ups. So as you've drawn off your pattern, I've got up here some examples on the wall. We've got the bodice front and the bodice back, and of course the sleeve pattern that I've just done in a short sleeve. When you finish drawing off your pattern, your center front on the bodice front is on the fold of the fabric, and center back on the bodice back is on the fold of the fabric as well. Now, obviously, you need to get into this somehow. So what I suggest on page 12 of your dress kit instruction book is that you need to add a 5/8 inch seam allowance somewhere. I actually prefer to add it on the front of the pattern so that it makes it easy just to wrap it around. But if you put the 5/8 inch seam allowance on the center back, then obviously you're going to need somebody to pin it shut for you, or you'll put a zipper in place. So let's go ahead and add the 5/8 inch seam allowance on center front. Now, a couple of things that I'd like to point out is, number one, I am working on the wall, and I'm only doing that for demonstration purposes. When you're doing this in the comfort of your home and sewing room, please make sure you're working on your sewing table. The other thing is that you'll notice that I'm using a heavy blue pen to mark everything so that you can see what it is that I'm doing. But again, when you're at home, you're going to be using a pencil, because we all make mistakes and you'll be able to erase it. And I know you're going to love this tracing vellum for that very purpose, because when you do start erasing, it's not going to go into shreds or holes. So at any rate, let's go ahead and get the 5/8 inch seam allowance in place. And you're going to do that very easily with your designing stylus. Use the straight edge, and there are the slots that indicate your seam allowance, and you're going to draw by the edge of the slot that is nearest the outside edge. So there I am drawing in the 5/8 inch seam allowance at center front, just simply using the slots that are provided on the designing stylus. Again, by doing this in pencil, you're going to have more accuracy as well in terms of the thickness of the line. So that's added on the 5/8 inch seam allowance, and now what we're going to do is take the pattern to the cutting table and see how to do layout and cutting. Let's talk about the fabric that you're going to use for this test. I know I talk about doing a muslin test, and again, I'm using that term very, very loosely. I do purchase muslin. Usually when it's on sale, I get a big bolt of it so that I've got it for testing projects. But if you don't have any muslin, think about your cottons. Think about what you might have in your fabric stash. And I've brought out a couple of different samples here. My preference is for you to use a solid colored fabric. It's just going to be a lot easier for you than a patterned fabric when you're identifying where the bust darts are sitting and how it's sitting at your shoulders and your seam lines and that kind of thing. So in the sample today, I'm actually going to be doing the layout on muslin and doing the cutting on the muslin, and of course the sewing and everything else. Let's take a look at the layout now. I've got my three pattern pieces, the bodice back, the bodice front, and the sleeve. And I'm not testing the skirt in this demonstration. This is, I'm only using the bodice. So let's go ahead and start working this layout. You place the center back, which is on the fold, and it goes on the fold of the fabric. And the bodice front is on, we needed that seam line, so I've put that on the selvage edge of the fabric. And then you want to weight your tracing vellum down. So I just use these little pattern weights, but if you don't have pattern weights, you can always resort to tuna cans, and that works as well. So either your pattern weights or tuna cans, and I also like to use a rotary cutter. You can use scissors if you want to, but I think the rotary cutter gives a cleaner, smoother edge. And so now I'm going to begin cutting on the seam line with the rotary cutter and go all the way around on that 5/8 inch marking that I have on the master pattern. And when I get up to the notch, I usually start the notch and go around with the rotary cutter, but I know I'm going to have to clean that up afterward with the a pair of scissors, because this doesn't get in and nip all of those fine little threads. There we go. Okay, so that cut out the bodice back. And I'm going to go ahead and do the same thing on the bodice front and on the sleeve. Something else that I like to do when I'm working with fabric that looks the same on the inside as it does on the outside is I like to just take one of these, their fabric marking pens, and I will do something like this, and I'll mark a W that says for wrong side, and I'll do it in a seam allowance area so that it's just not quite so obvious. I know it's going to wash out afterward, but if you do this, then you always make sure that when you place right sides together, that that's exactly what you're getting, is right sides together. All right, the next thing we need to do is mark in all of these darts, your fitting darts. And there's always more than one way to do any job, but I, in a case like this, particularly like to use tracing paper. Now, I am going to use this really, really bright red tracing paper. Again, if I was doing this for a real garment, I likely wouldn't use this bright red on the white because of the smearing. But what you want to do is you want to get the waxy side of your tracing paper towards the wrong side of your fabric. And then you just take your pattern and lay over top, get it all lined up again, and then use your tracing wheel and then just trace off these darts. And so when I go like this and like this, that will have marked the dart on the bodice back. So now we'll take a look at the inside of it, and you can see that red marking there is the backfitting dart in the back bodice. So I'm going to do that now for the bodice front as well. And these are the darts now on bodice front. Once again, that carbon side of the tracing paper is toward the wrong side of the fabric. And I'm just using the tracing wheel that has little notches on it to draw the dart in place, or a little jagged edge, I guess you would call it, on that tracing wheel. And now I've just shifted the carbon paper so that I can do the side fitting bust dart here as well. The center line of this dart has also been marked. I will draw that in. It's not necessary because I'm going to show you how to sandwich that together when you start stitching it. Let's take a look now at how best to sew your darts in place. Remember that we're on the wrong side of the fabric. I can tell by my little W there in the seam allowance area. And there are the marked darts in place. And now what I want to do is fold the right side of the fabric together like this. And I'm going to line up this little red dotted line with that little red dotted line, just to make sure I'm getting the dart evenly positioned on one side to the other. And so how I do this is I've inserted a pin on that red line, and I just squeegee that fabric until the pin comes out on the other side on that red line. And then I do that in the center of the dart, and you see that one wasn't quite on, so let me move this just a hair, little bit more, like that. Now the pin is exactly one line to the other, and I'm going to take the third pin out towards the tip of the dart. Now the intention when you stitch a dart is that you're going to sew it in the longest, finest, triangular point, and the point of the dart needs to stitch right off the fabric, because if you stop back or you get a little pokey here, it's not going to lay flat on your body. And I always line up my pins this way in relationship to the folded edge of the dart, because I'm going to start stitching at the wide end of the dart and then stitch to nothing at the tip. So that's the next step. And I did mention that I'm going to be using black thread on this off-white muslin just so that you can see the stitching. Now, because you're doing a test garment, you may want to put your stitching into a basting mode, but for this example, I'm just going to leave it at its regular stitch length. But you may want to do that, and then I always back stitch. Now, I'm at the tip of the dart, but what I'm going to do to finish this dart is continue stitching in thin air. I'm going to take about 4 or 5 stitches. I'll just raise that into the needle up position. Then I'm going to lift the presser foot, and I'm going to come back into that little tiny fold that's on the fabric. Now, set the needle down and do about 2 or 3 stitches and raise the needle back up. And when I take that away now and clip my threads, this has now locked the tip of the dart inside that little folded piece. So you don't need to worry about tying it off, and I just leave those threads there. And you're going to stitch every single dart in that manner for the entire bodice, and then we'll go and take a look at pressing your darts. Once you've stitched all of your darts in the bodice front and in the bodice back, then you need to press them. And what you're going to be doing is pressing your darts over top of a curved tailor's hem. The reason that you do that, of course, is because you've just stitched the dart, which takes a flat piece of fabric and conforms it into a curvature to go over the curves in your body. So you want to lay that dart and the fabric over top of the hem in the best position so that it's nice and smooth with no puckers at the tip of the dart. Then take your iron and steam iron and press the dart in the downward position. So that's the side fitting bust dart gets pressed downward. And then the waist fitting darts, you can press them either towards the side seam or towards center front. And in this case, I'm just going to press them both towards center front. And then on the bodice back, these two darts, these waist fitting darts, they'll get pressed towards the center back of the garment. And once again, do it over top of the tailor's hem. Now we're going to go back to the sewing machine and stitch the shoulder seams and the side seams. Next, I've taken the right sides, placed them together, and pinned them at the shoulder seams. And then you'll begin stitching your 5/8 inch seam allowance at the shoulder seams. And once again, I do prefer to lock stitch this just so that it doesn't start pulling apart when I start adding and testing the sleeves and that kind of thing, but you definitely can be basting this if that's your preference. Next are the side seams. I've placed right sides together, and I'm just pinning on a 1-to-1 relationship so that the underarm point and the waist edge are exactly the same, and then begin stitching once again at your 5/8 inch line. And it is important that your 5/8 be 5/8. You've drawn on a 5/8 inch seam allowance, and you want to make sure that you stitch at 5/8 so that everything is exactly the way it's supposed to be in your test. Now, stitch the other side seam in exactly the same manner. Now that you've stitched your shoulder seams and your side seams, it's time to press them open. And I find the easiest way to do this is over top of a seam roll. What the seam roll allows is for you to set the seam allowance on there and press just the seam allowance only, and not put wrinkles in any other part of the fabric. Next, we're going to start setting in the sleeve. And please do know that there are numerous ways to set a sleeve in. This is just one of many. How I prefer to do it is to put in two rows of gathering or basting stitches, one approximately 3/8 of an inch away from the cut edge and one just beyond the 5/8 inch cutting line. Additionally, you'll want to make sure that your stitch length is set at the longest stitch length possible, about 5 to 6 millimeters long. And I'll set that at the 3/8 position and then begin doing the long basting stitches for this sleeve cap. And you typically go from notch to notch. The second row. Is approximately 1/16 of an inch beyond the 5/8 inch line. And that's what your two rows of basting stitches look like. Next, we're going to stitch the side seam or the underarm seam of the sleeve. Notice that I've got my little W there, which means that's the wrong side. So I'm placing right sides together and pinning it in place. Now here, I'm going to just change my stitch length back to normal and stitch a 5/8 inch wide seam allowance. Now that pin that I have right here is designating where the flare on the bottom of the hem of the sleeve is going to be. So I stopped with the needle in the down position. I'm going to reposition the edge of the cut edge along my 5/8 inch line. Of course, you're going to stitch the other sleeve seam exactly the same way and go and press them both open. All right, the next part of putting a sleeve in is making sure that you get the right sleeve to the right side of the bodice, meaning the front to the front and the back to the back. And the way that I do that is in this manner. I turn my bodice so that the right side is face out, and on the sleeve, the right side is face out. And then what I do is I put my hand inside and I grab hold of the shoulder seam. Then I take the shoulder notch of the sleeve and I am sandwiching or facing those right sides together. And there you know that I've got it the right way, because there's the single notch on the sleeve indicating the front of the bodice, and there's the single notch on the front of the bodice. So now that I've got these pinched between my fingers like this, now all that I do is flip the bodice front over top of that sleeve, and then I put it all in front of me, and I work from the inside of the sleeve cap. So I place notch, the sleeve cap notch, to the shoulder seam, and I put a pin to secure that, and then I go to underarm seam to underarm seam. So that's the underarm seam of the sleeve to the underarm seam of the bodice, and I make sure that the seam lines are one right on top of the other, and I put a pin on either side of the seam allowance to hold it to lay flat. And then I start easing the gathering stitches up. So you pull your two top stitches together and I just gently pull on those gathering stitches just a little bit at a time, easing up the amount of sleeve cap fullness that there is and holding it so that it positions as flat as possible onto the bodice seam allowance. And then at that point, I'll start laying in more pins. And those of you who are really comfortable with the way you get this pinned in place can go straight to basting that sleeve in place. But if you're uncomfortable, I mean basting by machine, but if you're uncomfortable, you can always get it to this position and then hand baste the sleeve in place. So here I am on the other side of the sleeve cap, just very carefully, very gently pulling up these gathering stitches or the basting stitches to ease in that fullness from the sleeve cap. Then I hold it in relationship to the arm side or the armhole of the bodice and start pinning in place. There's a lot of pins that go into setting a sleeve in place, at least in my technique. Again, as I say, there's many, many ways to set a sleeve in, but this is the one I've used over the years and I've found to be the most successful. Now we start stitching the sleeve into the armhole. And I always baste that sleeve in place first of all. So I've got it on a really long stitch length. And the way that I do this is I stitch it so that when I've placed the fabric, the two seams underneath the presser foot, I've got the sleeve side up, bodice side down. And then I started at the 5/8 inch stitching line and lower the presser foot. And I'm gonna put the needle in the down position so that every time I stop, this needle will stop in the down position so I don't lose the relationship of everything that's all pinned together here. And you just do a little segment at a time and then turn, straighten out your fabric, stitch a little bit more, and then I start removing pins. Stitch a little segment more. So when I'm stitching this, you can see that I'm going slowly and carefully. And I always make sure that as I get towards any seam, in this case it's the shoulder seam, I lift up the presser foot and I make sure those seam allowances are flat in position before I stitch over top of the shoulder seam. And when you're stitching this arm size seam, this sleeve into place, always be using your fingers to feel that it's flat, that there's no folds or ridges underneath. Because if there are, it means that your sleeve isn't setting in there properly and it's going to have a pucker or a bulge in it and you're going to have to redo it. Just make those sure the seams are all flat as I come around to the starting point. So once you finish stitching this and basting it in place, then you want to check and make sure that everything looks okay. So the first thing to do is check the bodice side and that there are no puckers whatsoever and that you haven't got any fabric caught when you're stitching it. And then you want to check the right side of this as well and check at the sleeve that there are no folds or puckers on the sleeve side. And of course, that line of stitching there, that was one of the basting stitches that once I've checked everything and it's okay, then that line of basting is going to get pulled out. But at this point, this looks fine, so I'm going to put it back in the sewing machine with regular stitch length now, and I'm just going to stitch on top of my basting stitches. Once you've put in the final row of permanent stitches in your sleeve, and of course that you've checked it and that there's not a problem on either side, then you can go ahead and pull that basting thread out of there like this. And if you want to, you can pull out the first row of basting threads too. That's fine. It doesn't really make any difference. So now your basting threads are gone. Then the last thing that you want to do is trim your seam allowance about half the width. Or you can take this to your serger or overlocker and overlock and trim all in one fell swoop. It's just your choice however you'd like to finish off the inside edge of the seam allowance on the sleeve. Now, in order for this to sit comfortably at your neckline, you must stay stitch 5/8 of an inch away, and then we're going to clip into that stitching. And the reason that you want to do this is because when you put this on your body, if you don't stay stitch and clip to the stitching, it's going to pull at your neckline. So stay stitching is done with a regular stitch length, and it's done on the 5/8 inch line of where a seam would be. Keeping in mind with this test garment, you're not putting on a collar, you're not doing any special neckline. This is just the high round neckline, which is called the jewel neckline. And for it to really be tested properly and to see how it's going to fit on your body, this line of stitching and clipping into the stitching is really an important step. So that puts the stay stitching in place, and then you clip to the stitching. So whenever you see terminology that says clip to stitching, this is what it means. You're clipping right up about every inch or so. You clip right into the stitching so that when it sits on the curve of your body, it will open up that narrower portion of the inside curve and let it lay down flat and properly against your body. And one last line of stitching that I want you to do, and I want you to do this on both of the bodice fronts, is I want you to put a line of 5/8 inch stitching all the way from the neck point all the way down to the hemline. And the reason that you're doing this one is so that when you put this bodice on, that as you pull it around the front of you, all you're going to need to do is overlap this line of stitching, and you will know that you are exactly on the 5/8 inch line that was originally that center fold marking on your pattern. So you do this on the other side as well. Well, the good news is you're almost finished your test bodice, but before you try it on, please take it to your ironing board or pressing table for one last press. There's nothing worse than putting it on and having wrinkles everywhere and having them being distracting. So as we take a look at pressing this, one other pressing tool that I really like and use a lot is a sleeve board. And what I like about this is that I can now slide that bodice upper chest area and the sleeve section onto the board without pressing other areas of the bodice that I don't want to press. So if you don't have some of these pressing tools, you might want to consider treating yourself sometime to them so that it really will aid in all of your sewing projects. So give your test bodice a good press, and then you're ready to try it on. Well, now you've completely finished sewing your test bodice and you've given it a good press. Now it's time to try it on. And since I designed this body blueprint for Molly Mannequin here, that's who we're going to take a look at it on. Now, when you start evaluating the fit on your body, on page 12 of the dress kit instruction book, you're going to see a chart in the center to help you evaluate the fit of your bodice. But before we take a look at some of those areas of evaluation, I want to point out a couple of the places where I had you do some stitching and the reason for it. First of all, the stay stitching at the neckline, and of course the clipping into the stitching. The inside edge of that neckline is a smaller circle than this edge, and if you hadn't have clipped up to the stitching, you would not have had this sitting nice and comfortably at your neckline. So that's very important. And then the other thing that I had you do was put a 5/8 inch line of stitching at center front on both sides of the bodice. And the reason for that is so that when you put it on, that you can line one stitching line right up over top of the other and pin it closed and know that that is exactly center front. And then start your analysis. First of all, that neckline, of course, should sit comfortably at the base of your neck. And the shoulder line, Well, it should come right out to your shoulder bone, and the shoulder seam line itself should sit right at the top of your shoulder. And the armhole line, well, that arm size seam line, that should sit right where the crease in your body is, where your arm creases next to your upper torso area. As we take a look at the darts, all of your darts need to point towards the highest point, in this case your bust point, and you can see that these ones do. Typically, you stop your dart stitching back about an inch and a quarter to an inch and a half back, and that seems to be the most pleasing on the human body. You want to make sure that the waistline is appropriate for your waist level, and as we take a look at the back of the bodice, once again, it's fitting smoothly across your upper shoulders. The length is good for your back and the width is good for your back. And when you've got this on, I do want you to reach both arms forward to make sure you've got enough reach room in the back of your bodice. And there you have it, a really excellent fit. Now remember, I designed this particular pattern for the mannequin. When you design your own body blueprint, remember, you're using your personal measurements. You use your measurements to draw off your pattern. And so when you put it on, many of you are going to have an excellent fit straight out of the box. For some of you, if you do need to do any refinements or minor tune-ups, I want you to refer to page 14 through 16 in your dress kit instruction book, because there's a lot of refinements if you do need to do those minor tune-ups for your body, and some of you may need to do that. But you can just see how much logical sense this makes. When you get that body blueprint to fit your unique body shape and size, and then you start adding design features to it, different collars, different necklines, different sleeve styles, it's all going to fit you properly. And I know that you know that when you use SureFit Designs, you can be sure of the fit.